Hello, everybody. So I would like just to say before starting that I'm very glad to be here with you to share my views about innovation in Russia. I have heard Russian-speaking people here.
Yes, I'm Russian.
Здравствуйте. Очень рад вас видеть. Но я не буду продолжать по-русски. I will follow on in English. I just would like also to thank all the organizers, because I know that there are a lot of organizers that are not here, but who invited me today. It's very interesting for me to have this international panel of discussant, because I think we will have two main discussants, but I hope that there will be a lot of other discussions for all over the world discussing my views. And so it's really interesting for me to have this exchange with you. Okay, I will speak about a rather old article, because it has been published in 2014. So this means that it has been prepared during the 2013 or 2012 year. And because of that, I intend to propose a follow-on of this article, not only to present the views that have been published in this Post-Communist Economies number of this review, but also some questions that I think are interesting to discuss about all the surroundings, theoretical, empirical, also around that. Second thing I would like to say, maybe it is of interest for you to know how I come to this problem, because it's very personal, but it can be interesting because you are interesting you are interested in doing research. So it has been a long time since I started to follow Russia. I did my PhD thesis on the opening and transition of the Russian economy during the 90s. And okay, my specialty was at the beginning about only external trade, capital flight, and so on. But coming into INALCO, so National Oriental Language and Civilization Institute, that is a little bit odd for an economist to be there, but it's very interesting. I was the only one who had something to say about Russian economics and post-Soviet economics. So I had to enlarge a little bit my views, and I came to have some interest on how industrial policy is thought and elaborated in within ministries and the authorities in Russia. And this was very interesting, because it was a time when it was the 2000s, when at the same time you had this tremendous and very brisk growth, economic growth of Russia, almost a Chinese growth, 7, 8, 8.5, 10% even in the beginning of the period, year of economic growth. But at the same time, there was clear tendency to Dutch disease. That is, to the impossibility of the manufacturing sector to develop properly, because of a lot of problems, but among those problems, the fact that the exchange rate was overvaluated. And so I had to study this problem, and of course, industrial policy of and from the policymakers in Russia was interesting for that. But in order to study this industrial policy, and in 2007 there was this 2020 strategy in Russia that was called like that, and that was precisely intended to tackle this problem of deindustrialization. So there was some kind of materials on which I could work, And I discovered that working on this industrial policy without working on innovation and the way the whole system of relations between industry was organized was not as pertinent as it could be. So I had to go one step further and propose an analysis of national innovation system. So that is the path of my way to go into this problem, okay? Now, some words about the content of my presentation of today. We will start with some figures about innovation in Russia. This will be very, very quick for those of you who don't know anything about Russia and Russian innovation system. And the second part will be about the approach called national innovation system, because it's more or less a theoretical approach. So it's interesting to know from where it comes, with the main historical path, the main hypotheses, and questions that have been raised by these proposals of three main scholars about this NIS or NSI problem. And after that, I will come deeper into the Russian case with the Russia in the NIS framework, starting with legacy, current transformations. These things are a little bit treated in the article. Debates, policy-making debates, economic policy-making debates about that, and assessments. And we will, if we have time, because I know that the president will stop me if I'm too long, but if we have time, we will go further in speaking about the theoretical problem, NIS framework in itself, and also the recent changes of the Russian national innovation system. Okay, so we will start with this innovative Russia. Only two graphs. The first one is about patent application. This is domestic patent application. It means that it counts every patent application on the national board of application of patent, registration board of patents, okay? This is very important because this doesn't mean that it has any competitiveness, international competitiveness in the world. You just know that it's for your country, that's new, okay? And you have to protect it in your country, within your territory, okay? But that's all you know. And what is interesting is to see that Russia is here. This is a logarithmic scale because there is tremendous differences between countries. You see that all countries are growing, absolutely all, but that for Russian you start in the 1992 year by a brisk start, but then a very deep recession of patent application, and then a steady growth. Here you can see China. You can see that if the slope is like that in a logarithmic scale, what can it be in an arithmetic scale, okay? So you see that if you divide patent applications by resident and non-resident, you see that Russia is in the middle of the whole basket of OECD and big non-OECD country, BRICS country. But maybe we will come back to that, but I don't intend to do that. But you see that for the 1990s, it was mainly the only country in which patent application decreased, okay, in absolute terms. Second group of data about that. high-tech export intensity divided by GDP, not divided by export, because in the paper I offer also a graph dividing high-tech export by total export, but regarding Russia, that is not very relevant, because 70% of exports in Russia are raw materials, and if price of raw materials are growing, mechanically, the part of high-tech exports dwindle. So it's not very relevant. I think it's a better indicator to look at high-tech export relative to GDP, and there you see this diminishing trend, and you see that Russian Federation is lagging behind all other countries that were put in the basket before. Okay? So this is obviously the problem Russian authorities like to tackle and to overcome, if possible. Okay? Of course, here you can see one of the aspects of the Dutch disease, because you have a very brisk growth of the world GDP, but within the GDP, several sectors are not growing at the same pace, and the most high technology intensive sectors are growing less than the others. Okay? So this is to start to give you a first glance on this problem of innovation in Russia. You see there is a problem. Now we will come to the approach of national innovation systems, the National Innovation System Framework. And I will begin by two words about history. Lundvall was one of the main scholars who coined this term, and he was indeed the first who used this term in 1982, I think. But several years later, he recognized that this concept was a little bit not fuzzy, but very flexible, very different ramification, depending on the authors that who use them. Okay, so that was one of the remarks he made at this time. Strange combination, but secondly, great rhetorical power, because it was immediately adapted and used by policymakers. Not only by scholars, but also by policymakers. So that's interesting, because it's some kind of tool of policy of encapsulating politically an economic policy. Lundvall was not the only one who first elaborated this concept. There were two others authors, Christopher Freeman, who worked from this time with the OECD, and Richard Nelson. I think you know Richard Nelson, okay, from Nelson and Winter and so on. Okay. They have more or less the same definition of and use of national innovation system. Okay, they are coherent within themselves in using this this concept and its approach. What is less known but is very interesting for me is the fact that the main historical author inspiring this notion in Christopher Freeman world was Friedrich List, who was a German nationalist scholars and also businessmen in the beginning of the 19th century. And his problem was, okay, what kind of policy can we imagine for Prussia, Prussia, I think it's the name, Prussia, in order to catch up Great Britain. Okay, Great Britain was the uncontested technological and economic leader at the beginning of the 19th century, and the problem of Friedrich List was, okay, Adam Smith say that everything would be fine if we let all goods going through borders without any limitations. But isn't it linked to the fact that Great Britain is the technological leader? Okay, well, that was his question. And he answered that for lagging behind countries, technologically and productively speaking, it can be interesting, it can be efficient on the long run to protect some infant industries from the competition coming from outside and coming from more advanced countries. That's why there is this term of national. This can be appear bizarre, but this is linked to the fact that Friedrich List first spoke about national economic policy, national economic system. And also followed by a corpus of theoretical work called structuralist development theory, which is very, very much concerned with the problem of the structuration of economic and technological links between development economies and developed economies. But with this inspiration, what is interesting is that these authors were very influential, even in ECD, which is not precisely the place where you could wait for this kind of influence. And this concept had a very wide success. OECD, of course, used this concept a lot, but also UNCTAD, World Bank, the European Union Commission, the US, Japan, Russia, Brazil, South Africa, China, India. In all these institutions or countries, you have some works, even official works, quoting this concept and trying to adapt it to the national context. Okay. So what is the NIS framework? The main hypotheses are that structure matters. It means that you don't have only to pay attention to actors, but also to the links between actors. And the structural links, that mean links that are regularly used by actors, that is a structure. It's a set of links that actors use regularly, on a regular basis. And there are a lot of different structures in subsystems. You can delineate them. If you delineate this structure, you are describing a system. And you can try to compare from time to time, or from country to country, these structures and this system in order to see what is going on within them, what is going on between them, and if this kind of structure is more likely than another one to be efficient. The second hypothesis is the what is called by Lundvall interactionist hypothesis. It states that learning and innovation are both the outcome of interaction. Okay, that is to say that at the individual level, even at the individual level, the mere fact that you are in interaction with the other is the driving force of your learning. Learning is the byproduct of your integrations, interactions with others. And on some of his works, Lundvall proposes a kind of hierarchical approach of this NIS framework, distinguishing the core of the system, what is for him the main part, and the core is constituted by firms, private and public firms, in which innovation takes place in the first place, but not firms individually, separately, but firms in mutual interactions, and of course interacting with their relevant environment, that is to say, the knowledge infrastructure. This is his terms, okay? Knowledge infrastructure. And this is the core of the system, but there is around this core a wider setting with education systems, labor markets, financial markets, intellectual property rights, competition in product markets, and welfare regimes. That's a very broad selection of what is called a wider setting. In fact, in the paper of Lundvall that I used, all of these components were not used, in fact. Okay, so we will see that from time to time, Lundvall himself can depart from this list. But that is the ideal list of the wider setting components. Okay. And after that, I just propose a representation, graphic representation of the Lundvall approach, distinguishing two subsystems in blue, private and public, and distinguishing the financial system, R&D organizations, firms, and public sector. And you see that the core is here. Okay, in the Lundvall terms. This is what is described in this book, but not in this way. This is my way of representing the different components. And all these arrows, you can see, but it's not relevant for our presentation here, but it is relevant for the paper. You have some letters. And then we discuss all the roles of all these letters. But what is more important is, of course, the arrows of representing the structure and the interactions between the different actors in the NIS system. Okay, now, what are the questions raised by this framework? First, what kind of flexibility the authors of this framework allow it to have? And you see that for Lundvall there is quite wide flexibility. A definition of the system and innovation must, to a certain degree, be kept open and flexible regarding which subsystem should be included. You can see that there are some of the subsystems that we have seen in the previous slide that are not present there. And which processes should be studied? And second questions, we see that obviously there is one missing element, but in the book I used, It was acknowledged by Lundvall, it's the education system. It can be somewhere here, but it's not explicitly mentioned. And what is more relevant for me, it's the links with foreign organizations and institutions. And we know why this is like that in the Lundvall framework. It's because at the beginning it was to differentiate national innovation system from the current at this time mainstream thought about globalization. Means that there is practically no need to differentiate between economic systems because they are all too much linked with other economic systems. So nations are no more relevant for economics. Okay, and that was why Freeman and Lundvall proposed their framework, saying, no, wait a minute, you have difference between national innovation systems, even if you have globalization. But by doing that, maybe they understate, they do not put forward enough the links with foreign organizations and institutions. So that is why we can add this relations within the representation, these relations between national actors and foreign actors. Okay, now speaking of the adaptation of this framework to Russia, okay, I didn't do for this paper any field research, doing myself interviews and so on. I've been there, I have visited several technoparks and so on, okay, but that was not in a research systematical way. So I didn't use this kind of material. I use only public formalization of policy making, including legal text, policy making statements, scholar reports, meaning by scholar reports, report that I that are put to the that published for the authorities. Okay, and all these kind of formalizations of policy advices and policy aims, and policy decisions also. The second kind of material I used was some surveys that were available at this time of R&D actors. And it's interesting because these surveys are not coherent from one to the other. So that is very interesting because you can find very different material based on a survey of surveys. And of course, statistical data publicly available. So starting to adapt this kind of institutional analysis of innovation and research and development system in Russia, we can look back to what Christopher Freeman himself wrote about that in his article of 1995. He gives an example of two contrasting national systems of innovations in the 1970s. And he uses USSR. So this is interesting for us. And, okay, you have here six different features. And you see that he compares between Japan and USSR the gross expenditures on research and development, that is GERD, gross expenditures on research and development. This means salaries of all employees in the research and innovation organizations and investments, of course, but also day-to-day expenditures and so on. Okay, it's a very broad concept, GERD, divided by GDP, so GERD by GNP ratio. And you see that for USSR, it was higher at this time than for Japan. It compares also the proportion of total R&D at the enterprise level and company financed in the total. And you see that, of course, this is very different from Japan to USSR. It compares also a system in which integration and production and import are linked together. So in Japan, it's very integrated. In USSR, it's separate. Relations between users and producers, linkages with a subcontractor, very strong for Japan and weak in USSR. Incentives to innovate, with some differences also, but maybe not as evident as we could think at a priori. And of course, competition in international markets. So you see there is also an opening. And here you see that for USSR, in arms race, there is an exposure to international competition. So this is the legacy for the Russian national innovation system. So I will just give you some insights on the findings of the paper about the Russian innovation system using this representation. So if you look at private firms, you see that they undertake a low share of national GRD. GRD is very concentrated with a very small number of big firms that concentrate a lot of GRD done in the Russian territory. There is low formalization and low systematization of the innovation strategy. And there is the learning by buying feature that means that firms tend to buy and to import technologies and not to develop inner technologies within their own productive system. Okay. Within the R&D organizations, there is a small minority of private R&D institutes. You have many private venture capital funds, but they are all of small scale. You have this learning by buying, that means by importing characteristics of the research and development behavior of private firms, but that doesn't mean that there is broad integration of R&D activities with foreign organizations. Okay, there is this kind of paradox. You go just to the market, but you are not involved in deep relations. In the public sector, you have a problem in R&D organization and basic research organization, fundamental research organization, aging employees population. Still heavy dependency on the military-industrial complex. And inertial modes of governance as regards R&D organizations, public R&D organizations. You have a lot of, not a lot, but very important and pregnant public financial organization that are able to finance innovation. Here you have got some of the main organizations that are active for the moment in Russia, Russian Venture Company, Rosnanos, Kolkovo and Botnik Foundations, and the FASI institution, that is a foundation for financing innovations for small and medium-sized enterprises. And the public sector is, of course, symmetrically to the private sector, is handling a high share of growth expenditure for research and development. And you have also a big and growing defense budget since 2000, because during the 90s this defense budget plummeted. Okay. So that are, to sum up, the main empirical findings that you can put into this kind of framework. So, starting from that, there are policy dilemmas and policy choices to be done for the Russian authorities. So, the first that are taking place, that were taking place, but to a certain extent continue to be discussed in Russia, are what kind of ends have we to define for our national innovation system? Can we endeavor breakthroughs, autonomous breakthroughs? Can we perform very high level of research and development in order to be the first in the world on a specific topic? Or should we have to be first imitators? This is a very hot topic, and was a very hot topic in the debates in Russia during the 2000s. Second question raised. We are open, because we buy a lot of foreign technologies, but do we have to further integrate into the world in innovation exchanges and research and development cooperations or not? Or on the contrary, should we have to protect ourselves in order to develop our own norms, technological norms, and so on. Okay. You see that this is not very stabilized. These kind of questions are not definitely settled in Russia. I choose four main documents in order to show that you have some changing priorities from time to time regarding which kind of sector is to be priorized. Okay? So, would it be information and communication technologies? Of course, this is steadily considered to be one very important priority. But for other, that is not the case. Composite and non-metallic materials, there is only one document which propose this kind of sectors as a priority target. So this is not very constant, this is not very stable, this is not very current. Okay. Second interesting remark, the fact that at the end, policy regarding the innovation and scientific production is quantified, and very precisely quantified. Here you have a table of indicators of objectives for the innovative Russia 2020 strategy that was settled in 2011. And you see that starting from the figures of 2010, you have the definition of absolute objectives for each target, each indicator to be raised, developed, and so on. Okay. So this is very individualizing, very The state acts as a planner, okay, to set some objective for an individual target. Okay, you have a kind of bijection between target and actor. These are the main aims and the main sub-targets, and also the means to achieve these targets. Okay. But what are the assessments? For the moment, we don't have any assessment. Okay. We know that in the National Intervention System framework and Ludwal, the main component are connections and interactions. So the less connections, the less interactions, the lesser probability to be successful, okay, to have a successful national innovation system at all level, individual, between sectors, and between national and international, and so on. Okay. What is it for the Russian innovation system? One interesting findings of all the survey that I used was the fact that all actors involved in innovation consider that the main impediments for them to innovate are more or less linked with connection with others. Okay, I will just give you some examples of that. I said just a few minutes ago that from one survey to another, you don't have necessarily the same answers, not necessarily the same questions also, but not necessarily the same answer to the same questions. But you can nevertheless find some trends, okay? And these are the trends, the coherent trends that I found between the different surveys that I used for this paper, okay? So the first problem that Russian innovation actors put forward is access to finance. Okay. They consider that this is the main impediment for the undertaking of research and development activity. This means that this is concerning connection between financial and industrial system. Second problem that are very often raised by innovation actors, it's the shortage of well-educated, well-trained employees and managers. So this means relations between industrial system and educational system. Okay. And three others, excessive bureaucracy in their administrative environment. So this is also the link between industrial system and administrative and public sector. Insufficient effectiveness of intellectual property protection. Okay, so this means that you have both, you have two problems, problem within the industrial system with violations of intellectual property rights, but also in the connection with the legal system and the enforcement of the legal provisions. Okay, so you have a lot of relations involved in this statement. And last example, the lack of reliable procedures to assess risks and return of an innovating project. Okay, what does that mean? Okay, you can read behind the line. This is to say that from time to time, your boss says you will have to develop this kind of project. You know that is not a good idea, but you are compelled to do that. Okay, this is at the same time, it can be, if it's on the private, in a private company, it's only a management system, a management problem, but in a broader company, this means that there's political involvement in research and development projects. Okay? So you can see, this is why I introduce the political system within the national innovation system in the assessments of the actors of this system. Okay, these are the main examples of self-assessment or assessments of their own environment by Russian actors. So I will just sum up. I don't know if it's particularly the end. Maybe
No,
it's okay.
Yeah.
Okay. The main findings in 2013 were, first of all, a kind of hysteresis of the prominent role of state planning and state organizations within the Russian NIS and its policy making. The policy focus is on individual identified sectors and big state corporations, presses quantitative targets in predefined indicators, and to the contrary, a lack of attention to the quality of interactions between within the core and with the wider setting of the NIS. And precisely, these interactions are identified by the actors of the R&D and innovation activity in Russia are as the most important impediments to their innovative activity. So, after having broadly summarized the article, I will just give you some ideas about likely further work on this field. Okay, since 2014, what has changed in Russia and within the NIS of Russia? We can see that there is a continuously growing share of state and defense sectors in NIS, okay? With some kind of performance in exporting arms, for example, because you see that the arms exports of Russia is growing at a very high pace within the world. But at the same time, you have another very broad environmental problem for the Russian NIS, that is the Russian crisis since 2014, because this crisis are practically stopped all investment activity. Investment activity was very low during the 2000s, during the brisk growth, but it is lower now than it was at the moment. So there's a problem of renewal of equipment, okay, and lack of financing for that because of the world global recession. And the fact that in terms of economic policy, you have something that is new and broader than what we just looked today. That is import substitution strategy, but not only in high-tech sectors, but in a lot of sectors and even low-tech sectors, okay? So there is a changing environment for the NIS in Russia. Okay, so you have, it would be interesting to see, for example, if the targets that were settled at the 2020 strategy are being reached or not. Okay, I didn't do that, but I just saw that for one or two of these indicators, that was not the case. The indicators were flat and not growing. I have just seen one very recent article in Vaprosy Ekonomiki, that is one of the main research review in Russia concerning economics, that is looking at regional innovation policy. It's very relevant, the problem of a regional policy in Russia, because of the size of the region, because of the low density, economic and population density. It means that you have sub-regions that are very differentiated, one with another. So having a unified view of the whole national innovation system is not sufficient. You have to go a little bit inside the different parts of the Russian territory to know what is going on. Okay, and one of the main points of this article is to urge authorities to focus on some regions that could be the next target, because they are the most promising regions in the innovation activity. Okay, so you have, for instance, the Nizhny Novgorod regions, of course, Moscow and its surroundings, St. Petersburg, Novosibirsk, Tomsk, some historical scientific regions that are put forward by these authors in order to see, okay, we don't have enough enough finance to proper innovation and research and development all over the countries, so let's focus on these regions. But you see that it is still the same way of thinking, individual targets and individual indicators, and not trying to develop links between actors. Okay, and the last thing concerning the NIS framework, I use this framework, okay, but using it, you can feel that it misses some kind of property that you would like to see within a theoretical framework. So maybe it will be interesting to develop some kind of new way, new approaches, maybe to deepen this this kind of representation. The first example of way to deepen this kind of framework is to look more closely at the micro level, the level of the enterprise, of the firm, and to analyze the innovation workflow within the organization, so that to see how management abilities are involved in the research and development process. With R&D, of course, the link between R&D and industrialization, and then, of course, commercialization, and then the fact that within the commercialization process, you find new problems, and these new problems develop your ability to engage in new R&D activities. So this is obviously at the micro level, at the enterprise level, and this could be interesting to add it to be added to the NIS framework. Okay. To a certain extent, some of the scholars that are cited by Lundvall did that, but I think this could be developed. Second proposal, after having presented what is going on within the enterprise, going at the meta level and analyzing the influence of the innovative atmosphere. This is a very old word of Alfred Marshall when he spoke about industrial districts. But this is very interesting for me, because I think this is precisely what's going on all these digital and numeric hubs that you have in every big cities in the world. In Paris, you have something of 2,000, maybe 200s of hubs in which hackers and developers gather. Okay, they have nothing to do with each other except that they are hackers. Okay, but they exchange. And this is productive for them. Okay, this is what is, I think, encapsulated in the word atmosphere. Atmosphere. So it is not within an enterprise. It's around it, but it's relevant. And for instance, for R&D employees, of course, the fact that they are linked with local and education organization and research organization is very important. For the industrialization and the R&D process, financial partners are very important. But you see that it's only, it's mainly, not only, mainly for some parts of the workflow within the enterprise that these links are very relevant. Okay? And the links with customers, the links with competitors are very important to identify new problems and to develop the commercialization process. And more broadly, at the macro level, in fact, you have these kind of interactions, but they are in a bath, in a field of institutions that are of a national character that differentiate them from other national, but also international norms that apply in some way in the national territory. Okay, so you have this third layer of analysis that is also obviously very important to have in order to characterize this kind of broad problem of is Russia innovative or not. Okay. And this is what the social system and innovation and production analysis try to tackle. Here you have a Bruno Amable framework in which you see the interaction between all these components of the broad macro level of institutions and organizations that are more or less complementary one to another. And this institutional complementarity is one of the explanation of the inertia of the whole system, the fact that starting from a point you transform but not completely your broad system through history, and also the differentiation of performance, of course. Okay. So here you have an interesting diagram differentiating direct influence, according to Amable, of subsystem on other subsystem, and complementarity, that is indirect influence, because it's the action of both subsystem that is relevant, not only one. And you see again this problem of interaction and relations between individual component of the national innovation system. Okay, that is all for today. Thank you very much for your attention.
Good afternoon. I am Yasmin and this is Mustafa. And today we are presenting the paper Adapting National Innovation Systems Theory to the Russian Case by Julien Vercoeur. Well, the outline of our presentation, first I will define what is the national innovation system. And then I will explain the Russia's innovation system and the key actors in this process. We will talk about the present performance, Russia's current strategy, The problem that the country has been facing and its innovation process, our proposed solutions to this case, lessons from other country, and also raise some questions. Okay, so the National Innovation System Framework, its emergence happened in the 1980s because it mainly was developed by Freeman, Lundvall, and Nelson, because the three of them, they identified the necessity of a stream of research related to innovation systems. And it also has an institution and evolutionary perspective. Accordingly to Kahn, the purpose of the National Innovation System is to explain why countries with different institution configurations will have different economic growth. The findings, they reveal the importance of the national innovation capacity of a country, which is determined by the interaction of different factors, such as demand, societal challenges, political factors, and educational systems. In addition, it's also important to frame that the heart of the national innovation system are the companies. So without the companies, you cannot really have innovation within a country. So today, the national innovation system is a conceptual design that is adopted by many European institutions, and also by the OECD and the UNCTAD and the World Trade Organization. And it's also important to mention that in the national innovation system, it's important that there is a convergence between the state and the company. So the state can organize all types of research and innovation and support programs, but the companies are responsible for their technological and commercial success. Well, Russia's innovation system. Well, first, it's important to frame that Russia, it has a catch-up period that was between 1999 and 2008. In this catch-up period, there were economic links between innovation and productivity inside the country. And there was also raising public funds for education, science, and technology. However, it's also important to say that even though Russia had this catch-up period, there was a lack of labor capital. So there was a huge brain drain of students and researchers inside the country, mainly because there was not so much support in research centers and also research institutions in the country. So if we compare in 2008, the number of researchers in countries like Brazil or China, and mainly Western countries, was almost three times higher than in Russia. Yeah, and in the 2000s, many policymakers, they started to emphasize the need for the modernization of the Russian economy. And in the same period, the government started to invest in a change in the institutional framework. So public institutions, they were created to support this change. And within these public institutions, they created around 30 initiatives. The first of them was the creation of the Science City status, and it ended with the 2020 strategy, which main purpose was to shift the economic focus of the country in the oil and gas dependency to innovation process. So the key innovation factors that we identified in the Russian economy, accordingly to the paper, there is a Lundvall, Freeman, and Nelson approach that is this figure that frame four main factors to the innovation in the country, which are the public research and development institutions, the financing networks, the industrial organizations, and also the foreign actors. So these key innovation factors, they are important to explain because they will... I'm going to explain how all these factors, they reacted to the innovation process in the country. Between 2006 and 2008, there were around 3,000 organizations focused on innovation in the country. However, the research career was very discouraged in Russia, and there were no new researchers entering in the research market and also in the innovation process. So what happened is that the researchers, they started to get old in the institutions. There was an aging of the researchers, and also the public institutions had a lack of equipment at the same time. The financing networks, it's important to frame that Russia at that time, it had two main finance companies. One of them was the Russian venture company, that was the RVC, and Rosnano, that were characterized as fund of funds. And they were mainly focused on manufacturing, infrastructure, and education. There were also the industrial organizations, and between 2011 and 2012, the World Bank, it identified that only 20% of the industrial companies in Russia, they carried innovation. And also there was a difference between the intramural companies and also the companies that focus on the learning by buying. So the intramural was the companies that they use it to find this process of innovations inside within the company. And the learning by buying, as professor explained it, was mainly focused on importing products and the innovation process, both within the country and from abroad. And only, yeah. And then also the framework, it focused on the foreign organizations. And it's important to say that the innovation and the internationalization, they are very associated. However, in the Russian case, this correlation was not really found. And what were the achievements of this analysis is mainly that compared to Western countries, the Russian industry was not so innovative as expected. And here I'm showing the self-assessment of innovative activity by Russian enterprises. So we can see that 47% had no innovative product. So comparing this framework, we can see that even though Russia had an innovative industry and had this its catch-up period, it was not so innovative compared to other countries.
Thank you very much for your comments, both of you. It was very interesting to listen to you, to listen to the way you appropriate the and read the paper, and also the complementary input that you bring into the presentation. First of all, I will have two or three added remarks about some statement you made. First of all, during Yasmin's presentation, all was very clearly presented, very complementary to with my presentation. I would like just to add one example and one I think weakness within the research system, precisely research system in Russia, is a salary problem. The fact that wages are for public researchers are far less than other professions for the maybe the most performant student within the higher education system. For instance, in one of the leading higher education university focused on oil and gas industry, you could expect that, given the fact that it's linked to the oil and gas industry, teachers would be more or less well paid. But that's not the case. They are paid properly when you compare their salary with the salary of other teachers, but when you compare their salary with the first salary of their student, it's absolutely not the same ordre de grandeur, the same size and same scale. Okay, thank you very much. So that means that there is a problem within the world economy of incentives, because it's not in the oil and gas sector that you could find the most promising fields of research for the rest of the economy. Maybe it leads us to your last question, the question about the differentiation between you should have kept the question, because I will forget them. I'm absolutely sure that I couldn't be able to answer them if I cannot have a look to them during my speech. So, but this is one of the long-lasting problem inherited from this Dutch disease problem. I mean, this is a catchword, Dutch disease. Okay, it's mainly Dutch, Russian disease. Okay, because it involves a lot of other and more complicated problems than only the real exchange rate problem. But for instance, this problem of differentiation of salaries between the career that you can embrace when you are a brilliant student in Russia, within the innovation system, within the research and fundamental research system, and doing some non very high qualified job in heavy industry or oil and gas industry, that is a problem, an evident problem, an obvious problem. Okay. The second thing I have noted is that I will let just to emphasize the one paradoxical remark that you made, that sometimes the state has a good diagnosis, but still we don't see any improvement in policy outcomes. Okay, so that's true. And that has been the case for almost two and a half decades. You can find in Russia very harsh and very lucid and very, to my opinion, well-documented diagnosis. And within the state, within the highest authorities, the problem is how you can transform it in some kind of policy that will change the state of play and the nature and the most pregnant institutions in your country. So that is one of the problems. Okay, thank you very much. Coming back to your questions, when you spoke about Big Brother, I thought about my answer to this question, and it was before you asked it. Because, okay, it's absolutely true, and I'm the first to stress that, that the bath, the institutional bath, in which you are putting all these actors and relations of the system in the national innovation system, is very important. And that you can try to fix some kind of better links between some kind of some of these actors. This will not be enough in order to have macro effects if you do not change the bath. Okay, so that is exactly what the Bill Broder case is about. Okay, but. Can you say that in China corruption is not existent? There is no predation. Even the actual anti-corruption campaign is some kind of a game between big stakeholders within the political system in China, you see? So that's my first problem. I do not want to underplay this problem. This problem is absolutely prevalent, okay? That's obvious. But it's not sufficient to explain all the features of the national innovation system. And my second answer to this question would be to take the example of the software industry in Russia, because this industry was absolutely absent before the collapse of the Soviet Union. Absolutely absent. You didn't have any software industry. But it appeared during the 90s and during a period in which all other sectors, industrial sectors and high-tech sectors collapsed. Apart from very tiny ones, and then developed even in the 2000s. And now it is exporting about $6 billion of software by year, and hiring medium to high qualified employees, and there are around 100,000 of these employees within this system, and this system, this sector is concentrated within big cities, St. Petersburg, Moscow, Ekaterinburg, and Nizhny Novgorod, Novosibirsk, but it's a very vivid sector. So, why did this happen? This could be a very interesting case study, I think. It has not been done for the moment. I have some hypotheses about the reason why this particular sector, who display some very international features, because it's a very in deep integrated worldwide sector with a lot of very intense exchanges of knowledge of person with the rest of the world, but still it is fixed within Russia. So this is interesting to follow because it's a counter example, and we have, I think, to dig on this example to know what are the main reasons why this sector has developed. One very interesting feature of this sector is it's that it didn't have any state support. Okay, how relevant are the Chinese strategy to the Russian context? I think you just put forward one of the reason why the Chinese example is relevant. The Chinese example is relevant because it shows a case in which interaction with foreign actors is one of the key driving force behind the development of learning. And in fact, we can say that in many instances, the Chinese case exemplifies what is learning by buying. You would even say learning by stealing. But okay, let's say learning by buying. Because Europe steals also each other sometimes, and United States has stolen some kind of very high-level products from France and so on. So there are some kind of example of this kind within European countries, but it's not at the same scale. I mean, I'm convinced of that. Okay, that's not a problem. How property rights issues a problem of growth, okay? Innovation relating to social needs. I think this could be, I'm not sure I'm correctly understanding what your question is about, but I think that one of the way of answering this question is could be decentralization. It's not the center that can properly gather information about what are social needs. You have to differentiate among different regions, and in this respect, I think that it could be interesting to know what kind of social innovation could be enhanced at the regional and the local level. So, at first glance, my answer would be, let's look at the decentralization problem in Russia in order to give some answer to your question, okay? And barrier to university industry collaboration. Okay, I have some experience in dealing with universities. I have Russian universities. I have met a lot of different universities and university managers and so on. And there's a very wide variety of behavior within the university. You have the very old-fashioned inertial universities that are absolutely sunk costs in university. You see, it's you cannot progress. You cannot. The only thing you can expect is just to retire the person who are at the head of the university and hope that the young will replace them. And one of the problems in this university was at the beginning of the 2000s. The age pyramid, because you had at the top the old Soviet hierarchy, at the bottom the very young 25, 27 years old professors, and nobody in between. Okay, so you had this kind of feudal organization within this kind of university, but you have also university even. Of course, public ones. It's not a problem of being public or private. But of course, in private ones, I did not saw Soviet-style managers. But it could happen, but I didn't saw that. In which you have a very open-minded and very fluid dynamics of exchange. I can say to you the example of the Kazan University, for instance, in Tatarstan, and there are plenty of other examples. So, just take the good examples you have, good experiences, and try to devise some incentives for the other to follow these kind of examples. But that's easier to say than to do, of course. But that was one of my advices. Again, thank you for your questions. Yes? Okay, no other speakers.
You want to ask? No? Ah, no. Bye-bye.
Sorry.
You
want to leave?
Yeah.
Please?
Take five or six comments, and you have some words, and I say you continue.
Okay, thank you for your presentation. It was very interesting, especially for me because I'm from Russia. And my question was is about this innovation centers like Skolkovo that you mentioned. Could you please provide your personal opinion on this kind of centers? Do you think that they are really effective and they could really provide some incentives to innovate? Because I really I've been there, I was working closely to them, and I can say that there is they are struggling. They cannot, like young innovators, they cannot do anything because there is no financial support. Big companies, they don't collaborate between each other. They have really strong competition, so there is no open research. Nobody wants to collaborate. And only one, I think, field where innovations are really still developing is oil sector, like Gazprom, and they have a lot of patents, but it's not enough. I mean, we don't have real production. Manufacturing was collapsed after Soviet Union also collapsed. So I don't really think that, like you presented the first graph with a high-tech export, right? It was high-tech export. It's true, we don't have that because manufacturing was collapsed. And even if still we have some manufacturers of semiconductors, they are, all technologies are out of date. They produce the semiconductors, they're very proud of that, but they use the semiconductors to insert to these toys, or like it's really not high tech anymore. So, thank you.
Okay. D'accord.
Thanks for your presentation. It was interesting. My question is, sometimes look into this national innovation systems theory. It's a lot of talk about formalization, intellectual property, education, financing, etc. But it's all supply side. It's mainly supply side things. And my question is about the whole coherence of the Russian policy for innovation, especially the role, if there is any role of the fiscal policies and public buying from innovative sectors, or they are helping the innovation systems, or it's like sometimes it's going up and down, it might happen. And that's my question, maybe.
Thank you.
All right, well, thank you so much for the presentation. My question is, do you believe that there is only one way in which the innovation system should be built? Because for me, what it seems right now is that the problem of Russia is that it's just trying to mimic the US system. And it's not obviously because of the cultural reasons, political and a lot of other reasons, they cannot do it well, and this is one of the biggest problems. Because like even if we look back to the USSR, Russia, USSR at that time, they had a very high like education potential. They had a lot of scientists, a lot of research, even though it was like during the Cold War, so it was a lot of military research, but still the education and innovation was working well. And then after the collapse of the Soviet Union, what happened was that it was the transition and the countries of the post-Soviet countries tried to mimic the Western world, and so far there has been no success. So maybe there are other ways to bring innovation to Russia.
Okay, ça va. Tu peux répondre, par exemple?
Non, one more.
So my question is related to the question asked by Elena. Because I noticed that on the first slide, the measurement of the innovation system was with the patents. That was one of the indicators that was used in order to say that Russia was not very quite innovative. But I was also thinking that it might also be because the industries within Russia is not generally patent-friendly industries. So I'm not very familiar with the Russian industry, but in my case, I would think that if the industry, that the main industry in Russia is not friendly or coherent with what is being measured in the innovative system, then they would look like something that is not working very well.
Okay, thank you very much for this question. I will ask, I will answer them one after the other. First, the question of about Skolkovo. Okay, when I mentioned Skolkovo in my presentation, I mentioned the Skolkovo Fund, for innovation, okay? So Skolkovo Foundation and so on, okay? So your question was about the Skolkovo infrastructure. That is this very big and with very high political involvement cluster of higher education institutions, business research sectors, and fundamental research institutions, okay, put together in the same place. This could be presented as mimical to Silicon Valley, and so it was also presented as the Russian example of Silicon Valley. Okay. At the beginning, one interesting thing about the, this project was the fact that it was really open to international cooperation. And I accidentally witnessed the way in which in neurology, Skolkovo tried to contact scholars in France about being experts from a project about neurology and so on. So, but at the highest level, this project was put forward by the then president, Medvedev, and was maybe too heavily politically supported by Medvedev, because it involved political struggle for this project. And when you have, in any country, political struggle about around a huge project, some business people want to depart from that and say, okay, let the struggle settle down, and then we will see if we are going to do that, to this. And that's the first problem, political involvement. And second problem is, it is interesting when you take into account the problem, the institutional, the broad institutional problem that we have seen for Russia, and that is detrimental to business innovative activities. It is interesting to set this kind of special economic zone, because you can try some institutions within this zone, and if they work well, you can parting from this example, you can try to replicate in other fields. But for this, you have to protect this whole zone from the problems arising from the external environment. I think one of the problems of the Skolkovo project was that it was not sufficiently protected from this surroundings problem. It was an attempt to do that, but during time we witnessed that it did not succeed in preserving all the actors from the problems that were in the surrounding, in the wider surrounding of this this project. So maybe. Yes, and also the fact that even in the within the business you have so heavy conflict that you cannot build an environment conducive to investment, long-term investment. Okay, it's not only a problem of course the problem is political, but it's also a problem within business business units. You see. So maybe this is one of the differences between Skolkovo examples and special economic zones in China. Okay, this ability to separate for a moment one territorial component of your country to the other and trying something that you could not try in the whole territory because it's too difficult to do that. Okay. But I don't think this will be completely useless, okay? I don't think this project will be without any outcome. This was my first answer. And also, I didn't mention that in my presentation, but one very interesting fact, you mentioned Gazprom, is the fact that the first innovative company is Gazprom in Russia. Okay? The one that invests the most in research and development. This is the gas company of Russia. Okay? This is to say that you have this absorption capacity of oil and gas sector, of all talents, innovative power, finances, and so on. Okay. Could the state be one of the drivers of innovation in demanding more innovation in some kind of sectors? This reminds me of one of the questions that your comrades asked to me. Yes, and in fact, the state is one of the main buyer of innovation. In fact, in the for instance, the border police and defense ministries are both the demand side and the supply side in the innovation system in Russia. And this is working relatively well, you see, because you have a very stable institutional environment within this sector. I visited in Siberia one technopark, and technopark is this kind of place where small and medium-sized enterprises are gathered to innovate, to be together, and for only 3-4 years. And when they are strong enough, they leave the technopark and they have their own buildings and so on. Okay, so there was one of the enterprise in this place which was successful. But when we ask why it is successful, it because it has it, this company just had a long-term contract with the state for border control. Okay, it was a software company, but you see that the buyer that is stabilizing in the long run the horizon of this enterprise was the state. So you have some examples, but I don't think it could be sufficient to develop on a wider scale an innovation-driven sector. Okay, so it can happen for a sector, but on a broader scale, it's, I think, not sufficient. Just the third question was: is it useless to mimic the U.S. system? Okay, if we just look at what the authors I mentioned write about that, of course they say there's no one best way. You have various successful in various dimensions national innovation systems, and one national innovation system can be at one point of its history successful and then driven to failures because it hasn't the ability to renew itself and so on. So there, within this national innovation system, you are perfectly aware of the fact that you have not one recipe. Okay, that is not a problem from a theoretical point of view. And of course, this leads to the conclusion that in order to develop, not to be the best one and the most successful one, but to develop your innovation system, you are not compelled to replicate what has been done in Anglo-Saxon countries. okay, you can have effectively. The most important feature for Bruno Amable, for instance, I quoted just at the end of my presentation, is the complementarity of all the institutions. But my problem with the complementarity theory, institutional complementarity theory, is the fact that you can have pretty complementary institutions, but being in the lock-in, being locked, because they are complementary. So the mere fact that these set of institutions are pretty well fitted one to another is not the sufficient condition to develop dynamically your innovation system and be able to produce new products and new devices. Okay. And patent friendliness of firms. Okay, you may know that from the company point of view, whatever this company would be, you have two options. You have, well, maybe you have three options. If you are a leader, you can have the options of being open, okay? But this is only if you are the leader. And the two other options are to protect your innovation by using the institutional framework in which you are. So it means that you are confident with this its ability to protect you. Okay? And this can be a problem in some instance. And the second strategy is secrecy. And you know that, for instance, for not product innovation, but process innovation, secrecy is a dominant strategy. It's not a minoritary strategy. It's the vast majority of business enterprises prefer to keep secret their processes. Because when you patent, you divulgate your innovation, okay? So, I don't think that from this starting point, Russian enterprises would be more prone to secrecy than to patent. I don't know, but I don't think so. I think that maybe what is more distinguishing for them, it's the reluctancy to patent worldwide, because as I said, it's national patent, so it's patent registered to the national board that I mentioned there. Okay, but when you are confident to your innovation, you may think that it's safer for you to patent it internationally. And if you compare international patent between countries, you see that for Russia, Russia is very, very, very far away the other countries, even for patents that are registered in European patent office, because Europeans is the nearest potential market for these companies. So a priori you could think that you will find an intense activity of patenting in Europe from Russian firms, but that's not the case. And so what I think is distinguishing for the moment Russian companies from others is, I think, more importantly, the fact that they are reluctant to international patenting and not to patenting.
Can I just have a comment?
There's a microphone.
But I also wanted to.
just a
comment on that.
Sorry, so about patenting, I think it's also very much related to history and to culture, because like during the Soviet times, there was like the patent is something, the idea that came from outside of the Soviet culture. So they never had the idea of it. They never felt the need to patent. And what you were saying, that they like people in Russia are not very sure that their invention is international. It's because like this is completely foreign concept to us. It's a Western type of thinking.
I will have a very simple answer. Profit too was something very far from the Soviet culture. So if you try to explain by Soviet culture the fact that patent is not very important in Russia contemporary, why should profit book be? Okay, this kind of cultural and should be used with very cautiousness, because there are a lot of capitalistic feature that were absolutely enthusiastically adopted by Russian citizens. So why just patent?
Yes, but the problem is when we try to analyze Russia with a completely foreign concept, and that we don't really capture what's really happening in the country.
Oh, I am not saying that with the mere number of patents that are registered, you capture the whole story about the Russian innovation system. I have said that several times, okay? But I'm not sure that we will understand better the national system of innovation in Russia if we attribute the patent trajectory of Russia to the historical fact that patent did not exist during Soviet time. I'm not sure.
Okay, I have a question regarding the policy implications. Yeah. Don't you think that the major response to all failures of innovation system of Russian is just you might be increasing of financial incentives? Mm-hmm. You have mentioned in your presentation the wages. I just want to stress that this is really a huge problem, and like the average salary of public researcher varies from $200 to $300 per month, and this is not doesn't even cover the cost of living in Moscow, and this causes a huge brain drain, and also to move of the labor force to software industry, where the wages start from $1,000 per month. So the gap is really huge, and people are moving.
Yes, because it's a successful sector.
So, yes, and so maybe just increasing the public finance will resolve the major problems. Don't you think so? Because
it could be one piece of the answer of the problem. Mm-hmm. Yes. But I don't think it will address the other features that we mentioned, and we saw that it was a very systemic problem within the business, in the links between business and finance system, between business and public education system, and so on. So you will address with that. You will address one of the links, and I agree with you. But you have to tackle other problems in order to influence in a productive way the world trajectory of the national innovation system. Of course, it's not useless, of course. But you will have, at the same time, to tackle other problems that we saw during this presentation. Okay?
Thank you for the presentation. I have three comments or questions related to you. You listed five findings for Russia, including financial institutions and education being two of them. And I read a couple of years back that former ministers of finance, both during Gorbachev government and Yeltsin administration, said that trust was a major issue in Russia. And that innovators don't trust people with financial power, so innovations aren't realized in Russia, and they end up being realized in other countries instead. At least they said that was a major issue.
Okay.
Second, there's also, I don't have the numbers, but I think there's a lot of cities and communities in Russia, especially as you move eastwards, that still rely on backbone industries from the Soviet era. How can that influence the education system and the lack of experienced employees that Russia currently have, and third, you also said that the military, the defense budget is becoming a more and more important share of innovation in Russia. Mm-hmm. And if I'm not wrong, the military budget for 2017 is cut by 25% from the budget in 2016. Mm-hmm. How do you think that can influence, as defense can be seen as a driver of innovation in Russia, maybe? How would this instability in funding affect that? Thank you.
Okay, I will take these three questions at once. The first question about trust in finance. Okay, you're right. There is a mistrust among business leaders, those who are not linked to big finance, toward finance. But I think there's another very, very big problem is the fact that finance, the financial institutions, even public ones, I mean those banks that are more than 50% state owned, are not interested in financing innovation. So it's the reverse link, which is, I think, maybe more important than the one you mentioned. Because, and this is not only about innovation, it's about investment also. Because when you see how much investment can be low tech, it can be just to renew your equipment, to modernize a little bit, but not to be high-tech. And when we speak about national innovation system, we don't necessarily speak about high-tech, okay? We can speak about low-tech innovation also. But investment is a guarantee that your trajectory can be stable on the long run, whatever it be. Only 10% of investment is financed by bank. Okay, and this has not changed since the 90s. So you see that investing in real project, industrial project, is not the main activity of banks and financial institutions in Russia. And that is a very huge problem, very huge problem. The behavior of the finance system and of the bank system in Russia. Cities, okay, yes, you're right. There are a lot of mono cities, 300 cities that are relying on one big industry. I think one of the outcomes of this structural characteristic of the economic geography of Russia is the fact that you have a broad range of regions in which competition is very, very low. And the problem is not to have the competition, the most high level of competition in the world. You know that in China there is very harsh competition between private sector and public sector, within the private sector also. But it's not on. The aim is not to attain this level of competition. This competition could be detrimental to long-run investment also. But to enhance a little bit the competition in this kind of regions, that could be something that could change behaviors and induce more modernization-oriented decisions within the business industry. But this is also linked to what we saw during the discussion about predation and so on. When the level of threat from a newcomer is raising, there are some, at the regional level too, there are behavior of captation and destruction also. And this is not sufficiently tackled by authorities. Okay? This is for the second part of your question. And yes, defense, the cutting of the in the defense budget that is effectively scheduled to next year will have some effect on the big programs. What will be the reaction? The reaction will be to secure some financing for the high priority projects and to shut down the other ones. Okay, so they will have a choice between some kind of programs, and some programs will be shut down or frozen. Meanwhile, the other would be enhanced because there is a strategic aim in exporting, for instance. That will be the outcomes of the cutting of the budget. You have a...
I was just going to mention to the second point of backbone industries. Also, if I'm not mistaken, over the past few years, a huge chunk of the sovereign wealth fund in Russia has also been spent in order to save those firms. Yeah. Which can
not only the firms but the banking system.
But also to those firms in those cities that fully rely on them. I'm not fully sure, but at least I read something related.
You have two very big problems regarding finance now in Russia. The first is the banking and financial system, because it was threatened by both the dwindling of the oil prices and the sanctions. And the second problem is the local finance, because you have a lot of spending that are under the responsibility of local finance, but not enough financing. So these are the two problems that the state budget has to try to alleviate from time to time in an urgency manner. Okay, and this is absorbing the bulk of new financing means. This is why there has been this big privatization in the past 2 months. First of Bashneft and now Rosneft, in order to alleviate the burden on the budget. Okay, but this is linked to two very urgent problems. That are financial problems within, for instance, Vinesh-Ekonom Bank. It is one of the main problems within the financial system, and regional and local public finance.
Thank you.
Something more?
Can I ask you one more question?
Yeah? Yes, you can.
No, you talk about a lot about Gazprom, and I'm Brazilian, and it's the some trends. It's very similar. No high tech exports, but also in the other hand, the most important sector is the oil sector, the most innovative, and it's based on a state company. So it's pretty much the same Dutch disease, if you want to argue. And in the case of Brazil, so this Petrobras, it's very important to develop the innovative system in the most high-tech parts of the Brazilian industry, and also another sectors around the oil industries, like naval industry and other kind of industry. And this couldn't be a way for the Russian economy as well to use Gazprom as a public tool, instead of just looking at the bad side of the oil sector. I mean, it's a natural advantage.
Of course. Yes, and you may have noticed that amongst the sanctions, there were technological sanctions, and technological sanctions were oriented toward oil and gas sector. So that is because there is this potential. Okay, there is indeed a potential of enhancing a lot of innovative activities when we speak about better efficiency in exploiting oil fields, or going deeper into the ground, or deeper under the sea, or deeper into the Arctic frozen sea You have to develop a lot of innovation in the Navy, in the other component of the whole technical system that you will develop in order to extract oil and gas from the from the earth. So there is a potential, of course, and there are spillover, of course. Okay, but at the same time, not all the potential has been used for the moment, and there are a lot of possible innovative activities within the manufacturing sector also. And if all the fundings and all the investments is channeled to this sector, because it's in this sector that you will find the highest rate of profit, it inevitably crowds out fundings from these potential activities. So that is the problem with the oil and gas sector. It's not only the fact that you have this Dutch disease effect, it's also the fact that you have the crowding out effect from other other industrial sectors that could be developed.
So now I think it's holidays.
Okay.